Namaste. In this session, we are going to look at the Bayen's variance trade-off and how does it relate to overfitting and underfitting. Now, let us take a very simple analogy to get started. I'll give you three choices. First is you stay very close to a mobile cell tower to get the maximum possible internet speed, but then also get exposed to the highest amount of radiation coming out from the cell tower and bear the health consequences that it has. The second option is to stay very far away from the mobile cell tower for the health reasons, but then get a very tortoise-like internet speed. And the third option, stay at a decent distance away from the mobile cell tower, making peace with a slightly slower internet speed, but also getting medium to low exposure to the radiations and hence live a healthy life. So which of these three options would you choose? Of course, you would definitely choose this middle ground, right? Because you do not want to be very close, you do not want to be very far either. Now, bias and variance, they plague all of supervised machine learning, and high presence of either bias or variance can result in overfitting and underfitting, and it can put the brakes on the capabilities of a machine learning model and render it not so useful. Now, we cannot force either of this bias or variance out of our model completely, but we can try and possibly minimize the effects and achieve a stable model. So now for example, imagine on the x-axis I have the age of people and on the y-axis I have their IQ, the IQ level. These orange dots are the 14 people who are in my training set, and I measured their age and their IQ levels and plotted them on this graph. And now I want to calculate the IQ of these black dots which are shown here. Okay, so I need to create a machine learning model to help me in this case. Now just imagine, after training the model, we find that the relationship is in this red colored manner, right? For example, this was the predictions that the model has made, and this is the prediction line. Now when I try to test my test data on this, I will see that there is a huge difference in what the predicted value is and what my actual value is. You know, in most of the cases, I have a huge difference in both these values, because in my actual test value, for example, my IQ was to be 80, but my predicted will be, for example, 100 in this case. Right? Now here, for example, my original is 50, but my prediction will be only 30. So there is a huge gap in the predictions, right? And this is called a residual, by the way, the difference between the actual value and the predicted value. So now this is overfitting. Now we will come into these terms, what these bias and variance means, in just a moment. Now just imagine, instead of this squiggly line that we created, we fit a straight line to this model. So now if we check how is our model doing on the testing data, we see that it is doing moderately well. Right, you see on these three points, it is doing a pretty good job, but not on the other points. And also you see that this model is not accurately describing the relationship of age and IQ, because this is just a straight line, but we see that the line should not have been straight. It should have a little bit of curve, but it also shouldn't have been such a curve, right? So this is underfitting, where we are not able to learn all the nuances of the data, and this is overfitting, where we try to learn everything there is in the data. So a good fitting model is somewhat which is between these two states. There are these two terminologies, bias and variance. Now bias is calculated on the training data and variance is calculated on the testing data. So now what is bias? Bias is the sum of squared differences of the actual, that is the training data, and the predicted values. For example, these are my actual training data, these orange dots, and my predictions are these red colored lines. Okay, so this is my prediction line basically. So if I try to see what is the value for this prediction point, it is the same as this orange dot, right? So the prediction value is the same as the actual value. So if I try to calculate the sum of the differences, it will be very close to zero, right? Because if this value, for example, was 10, this IQ was 10 for example, and my prediction is 9.95, then it will be pretty close to 0, right? The sum of squared differences. So I just have to sum all of these up, the difference between the actual training data and the predicted values. That is my bias. And what is my variance? My variance is the measure of how my predicted line would work on unseen or the test data. So now this was the training data done, but when I check out my testing data, I see that it has high variance, right? There is so much deviation from the testing data of this prediction line. And hence, for overfitting, we have a high variance and we have a low bias because the sum of squared differences is very small. So this is overfitting. Now for underfitting, we see that if we try to calculate the difference between the predicted and the actual values, for example, if this was a 10 IQ and my prediction value for this particular person was 13. So I have to do 13 minus 10, 3 the whole square 9. So I have to do this for each and every value. I have to calculate the sum of squared differences of the training data and the predicted line, and that is my bias. So now you see, in this case, we are going to have a high bias because our prediction line is not quite fitting to the training data. But if we check out variance for the underfitting, we see that some data points are pretty decently predicted, but while some are not. So it has a low variance, but it has high bias. So this was underfitting and overfitting. So if I were to just summarize in a table, this would be it. For overfitting, the error between the training data and the model predictions is small, as we can see here. Now for error between the testing data and the predictions, we see that the errors are huge. So this is big, and it is the reverse for underfitting. So what would be a good fit model? Well, a good fit will be small in both the cases, right? So if we check this, now this is for the same example. Now if I draw, for example, this curved line, this green colored line, as my model predictions, now don't you think that this would give a better prediction of our true underlying function? Because we see that our function does really look like this from the naked eye. So now when I calculate the bias and the variance, I'll have low bias and a low variance. So this would be a good fit model. Now just in case you don't believe whatever I have said just until now, let us discuss these plots which I have taken from the official scikit-learn website. Now this orange curve is a partial cosine curve, okay, and these are the training samples. Now I have drawn three particular lines to try to map this data. So first I am drawing this straight line which is a degree 1 polynomial. You see, because y is equal to mx, this is a straight line. Now this is a degree 4 polynomial, so now I am trying to map the input data correctly. And this is a degree 15 polynomial. And you see, now it is trying to just map every single input data and trying to touch every single data point. So now just tell me, which of these is the underfitting, overfitting and the good fit model? Yes, this one is the underfitting model, this one is the good fit model, and this one is the overfitting model. Why? Because we are just simply drawing a straight line without paying attention to the true underlying function. Here we are trying to map as close as possible to the true function. And here we are not trying to map the true function, but we are trying to map each and every individual data point, right? So this is overfitting. And mathematically speaking, if we calculate the mean squared error, testing values are not present here. Now behind the scenes, scikit-learn calculated the difference between the validation, that is a test set, and the model predictions, and it found that the mean squared error was 4.08 into 10 to the power minus 1. Now for the true function, it found that the mean squared error was 4.3 into 10 to the power minus 2. So you see, now this mean squared error is 10 times better than this mean squared error. This is 10 to the power minus 1, this is 10 to the power minus 2. So this is 10 times better. And if we check the mean squared error between the training data and the model predictions, we'll find that the mean squared error is 1.8 into 10 to the power plus 8, which is a huge number. Okay, So basically the point is, the higher the mean squared error, the less likely it is that the model generalizes correctly from the training data. So we can keep a check onto the overfitting and underfitting in this way. Now, to give a small example, just assume that the underfitting is the naughty kid who doesn't even know that there's an exam, but on the exam day, he somehow guesses or copies his way to average marks in the test. So it has not learned anything for the exam, okay, so it is just coming straight into the exam without any knowledge, and it is trying to guess or copy the results, and it is getting a decent result, not the best result, but a decent amount of result, which we see here. Now for the true fit model, it is an attentive kid who understands the concept clearly and thus gets very good marks in the exam. So you see, it has understood the underlying true function, which was the orange one, and hence it has built a model which is very close to the real function, and thus he gets very good marks or a very low mean squared error. And for the overfitting, it is a mug-up kid who does very well on the solved examples in the class, but when it comes to the exam day, he fails miserably because he has no idea how to solve the new questions. Just imagine that these sample points are my training data, right? So these were the solved examples in the class. So the mug-up kid just mugged up all the answers of all these points, but he didn't know how to approach that particular problem. So when it came into the exam, he failed miserably. So this was underfitting, overfitting, and good fit. Now, how to detect overfitting and underfitting? Now, if a model performs excellently well on the training data, for example 90 to 95%, but fails miserably on the testing data, for example around 60 to 65%, then we are definitely overfitting. Like we saw here, it was achieving a very good result on the training data, but when it came to the testing data, it failed miserably. So this is a mug-up kid. Now if a model performs very poorly on both the training and testing data, for example if it performs 65% of the training data and 60% of the testing data, then definitely we are underfitting, because we have not managed to extract the whole information from the training data, and hence we are getting such small value, and which means that there is still scope for much learning which the model can do. Now just imagine if a model performs poorly on the training data but excellently well on the testing data. So what does it mean? Well, have you hit the jackpot? Unfortunately, no. It is a sign of either data leakage into the test set, because it could mean that you have inadvertently peeked into the test set while training, so you have a knowledge what is present in the training set, or that you had a relatively small testing set to begin with. For example, you had 1000 training data and only 5 testing data, so on those 5 you can get all 5 correct, you can get all 5 wrong, so you cannot just base your decisions on such a small testing data. Or maybe it is just through a random chance that you landed up upon this result. So the possible solutions are, just shuffle your data set, increase your test size, and build your model again. Because this is not desirable and it is also not very common to happen, but sometimes it may just happen. So just watch out for that. Now, so what is an ideal machine learning model? Well, a model which has low bias on the training data and low variance on the testing data. So just imagine that it is a very good fit model which is making the trade-off between the bias and variance so that none of those is very high, right? So now, thus, if you have a model that fits nicely onto the training data and at the same time generalizes onto the testing set equally well, well, you have hit the jackpot. So the bottom line being, just make sure that you are consistently making good predictions on the testing set. So this is actually what I mean when I say consistently making good predictions, because you see, our model prediction line is mapping the true function very well, hence it will make consistently good predictions, which is not going to be happening in either underfitting or overfitting case. So this is called good generalization onto the testing set. Mathematically speaking, we can classify the bias and variance into a number of total error. And what is that total error? It is a reducible error and an irreducible error. So what is this reducible? It contains the error due to the bias and variance term. And this irreducible, it is the inherent noise present in the data which cannot be reduced. So you just have to make peace with that. When the model complexity is very low, so by complexity, I mean that I am using, for example, maybe less features, or maybe I am using less training samples. So for example, until here I've used 100 training samples, here 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, etc. So just as I keep on increasing the number of samples that I am training upon, the model complexity will increase. Or as I increase the number of features that I am using for my training, the model complexity will increase. Now, if my number of training samples is less, then obviously I have not learned much from the training data, and hence I'll be underfitting, and which will lead to a high bias. And as I keep on increasing my training data, as I keep on learning, I'll find that my bias term is continuously decreasing, because now it will try to overfit onto the training data. For the variance term, when we have very low amount of data, the variance will be low because we are underfitting. But as we keep on increasing the number of training samples, we'll find that as the model keeps on overfitting, our variance term will increase, because we saw that in the previous few slides as well, that when the bias decreases, the variance increases and we kind of overfit our data. So we have to find a middle ground somewhere, and that is the best fit model. Well, that is the dream again. So one more graph. Just as you keep on increasing the number of training samples or the model complexity, you will keep on reducing the training error, and the validation error, it will decrease up to a point, and typically it will just rise again after a certain point. And that is the point that you need to find, that okay, this point, up until this point I was getting the lowest validation error, and this is my sweet spot, and this is where I need to stop my training, and this is where I'll get my best fit model. Okay, now signal versus noise. Now what is signal and what is noise? Just for example, consider this toy dataset of 5 neighborhoods of a certain city, and our job is to find the average price in that neighborhood. Now all the 5 training data samples are from one city only, and now for example, if we are given a new neighborhood F, should we predict the average house price for this new neighborhood based on all of these features? Now what are the features do we have? We have household average income, the proximity to the sea, the population of that neighborhood, the number of people who wear the spectacles, the number of potholes in that area, and the number of street dogs in this area. Now, do you think we should predict our average house price based on all of these features? No, right? Of course, the spectacles, potholes, and street dogs are the noise features, because they do not, because although they are present in the data set, they are not going to contribute much to the average price. Like for example, I cannot say that since there are 541 people with spectacles, these are the geeky people, so they will be earning more, and hence the average price will be more. I cannot say anything like this, right? I also cannot say that since I have only 2 potholes here, which means it is a good neighborhood, so which will have a high average price. For example, tomorrow I call the municipal corporation and fill up all the 24 potholes here, so now this will be zero. And so you see, it isn't quite making sense to include these features in our average, in our data set. And also for the street dogs, in a similar manner, it doesn't really make sense to include this feature. So the other features, like the number of households in that neighborhood, the average income per household, and the proximity to the sea. For example, the more nearer to the sea a house is, a neighborhood is, the higher will be the price, right? So these are potentially the signal features. So we need to just keep a track of which are noise and which are signal features, and get rid of the noise features, which will basically lead to overfitting. Because if we learn from every single thing, it will try to overfit on our data. So some useful ways to avoid overfitting. First of all, train with more data. Just imagine I want to predict the average price of a house in the neighborhood which is not from this city, okay, which is from a different city. So can I use this data set to calculate the average house price in that neighborhood? No, right? Because we are only looking at this data, so we cannot just extrapolate to some other city. Hence, we need to include more data in our data set from different cities, from different states, so that we'll get a more holistic view of our data. The other method is to reduce the number of features, which we saw in the previous example, by deleting these spectacles, potholes, and street dogs columns. We can potentially get better results and we can avoid overfitting. Now, another way is to reduce the complexity of the model using techniques like bagging, boosting, regularization. So we can tweak this regularization parameter to make our model more complex or less complex. This is basically reducing the noise in the data. This is basically reducing the number of features. So these noise features, if we reduce them, then we can obviously avoid overfitting. Now, some useful ways to avoid underfitting. So now first one is to train with more data, because if you're underfitting, that means the model has not learned much from the data. So if you add more data to the model, then obviously it will learn more and more, and hence you will approach that point of good fit model. Then that obviously I would be underfitting my data, because I have more scope to include more potential signal columns into my data to predict the average house price. So if we are underfitting, so it is a sign that I have to include more signal features into the data set to predict the average house price, because this households column is not enough in itself to do the job. Next one is to increase the complexity of the model using the same techniques of bagging, boosting and regularization. So this regularization works in both ways. You can increase and decrease it to fine tune your model. And of course, reduce the noise in the data. A good fit model will have the low amount of noise. So reducing the noise should be one of the things that you should always look at if you're trying to achieve a good fit model. So now there are some useful curves which are used for checking underfitting and overfitting, which are called the validation curves and the learning curves. Both are extremely powerful in diagnosing our results, and we will look at them in depth in future videos. So I hope I was clear enough in making you understand what bias and variance is, and how they can badly affect our model, and how we can minimize their effects using boosting, bagging, regularization, etc. So that would be all for this lecture. So thank you for watching.